Jade, and I'm a contract user experience designer. I try and help businesses solve their various problems through digital design. So my talk is about minimum viable products. So we're going to explore the most misunderstood acronym in the digital sector. So what I'm going to go through is what an MVP is, what it isn't, give you examples of what good and bad MVPs look like, and then at the end I'm going to give you a small sentence set process which I use to conduct successful MVPs. So to start off with, the term MVP has been changed a lot over the years, and if you Google MVP, you might come up with a bunch of results. I've seen maximum viable product, or a MAP, MIP, minimum, a maximum impact product, minimum level product. There are actually about 100 different terms for MVP out on the internet, and this is my favourite, the Ninja Impact product. I don't actually know what that means. But as you can see, there's obviously a lot of confusion within the digital industry. Nobody seems to have a clear understanding of what an MVP is, how to operate it, how it works. And as a result, companies tend to make up different names, try and iterate on top of that, and sometimes they fail. In the past 9 months in the UK alone, 235 startups have failed. And you can read their goodbye notes online. It's quite sad, but a little bit misogynistic. I've moved to misogynistic. It's a little bit sad, but funny. But they always reference the fact that they didn't pivot when their MVP failed, so they didn't respond when something didn't perform well. So with that in mind, and all of these companies don't quite understand what MVP is, what the hell is an MVP? It's really simple. It's the smallest thing that you can build that delivers the most customer value. So by the smallest thing, I mean that could be as simple as a little button or a new feature, or it could be something new entirely. It's a very flexible process. An MVP, as it's an experiment, is nearly identical to a scientific experiment. So you have your hypothesis, a methodology, you have your analytics. It's very simple to do so. So an MVP is essentially a way to learn something incredibly quickly with the least amount of effort. What an MVP isn't, however, it's not a skeleton product, or as I call it, a half-assed solution, where you just try and throw something out into the open and you try and get feedback as quickly as you can and you just hope it works. That's not what an MVP is. An MVP also isn't only for startups. Companies all around the world, big and small, do MVPs all the time. A really good example would be Spotify. They run one MVP monthly. I don't know if you've noticed, but their site changes all the time because they're always testing new things. So with that in mind, why do an MVP? There are loads of reasons, but I'll just go through the top four. Again, so you can test an idea without committing to development costs, or as many development costs, I should say. They can be conducted very quickly and very cheaply. It enables you to get user feedback in a controlled environment. So you could conduct an MVP on just a small percentage of your users, or you could maybe run an MVP for just a week. Whatever really works for you, it depends on what you're trying to test. And the main reason I think you should conduct an MVP is it enables you to validate whether the problem has been solved or not. So what I'm going to do now is give you an example of a successful MVP. Am I in the way of you? Sorry? Okay. So, Dropbox. I'm going to assume everyone either uses or has at least heard of Dropbox. It's an online storing and sharing company for files. So the founder, Drew Houston, in 2007 found that storing and sharing files for him was an absolute nightmare. Obviously, back in 2007, cloud storage wasn't a thing, so everybody relied on USB sticks, and he openly admits that at least once a month he would catch the bus to work, forget his USB stick, go all the way back home, pick up his USB stick and go back to work. So for him, it was an absolute nightmare. So what he did is he built a prototype of Dropbox, and it was, in his words, it was shit. It only worked for about three people, it crashed all the time, it would corrupt his files, it was absolutely terrible. It was everything but ready to go out to the market. But he knew there was a problem. He had a hypothesis, which was people face a file synchronization problem they don't even know they have, and storing their files online will solve this problem. But because he couldn't prove to anyone that it was a large-scale problem, he couldn't get any financial investment, so he ran an MVP. So one weekend, because Drew actually, I don't know if he was a developer, but he could make websites anyway, he created a single-page website. And this is what the original Dropbox website looked like. It was incredibly simple. The users who visited, they could watch a video, which he recorded at home on his PC one weekend while he was making the website. you could click the download Dropbox button. You couldn't actually download it at the time, it didn't work. What it took you to was one other page where you could enter in your email address and show that you were interested in the product. So he made it really cheaply, he made it really quickly, and this method of MVP is also commonly called a landing page experiment. So, how did Drew do? So, he managed to get 75,000 people in 24 hours to sign up to say that they were interested in an MVP, which in turn validated his hypothesis. And as a result of that, he managed to secure investment for the full development. I mean, the bankers couldn't really say no. 75,000 people in 24 hours is pretty magnificent. So why did Drew's MVP go so well? And he did a very simple thing. He had a hypothesis. He believed that he could solve this problem. And he also had a way to test it. And it was an MVP because it was very short. It wasn't 100% working, but he could prove that there was a need. I'm going to give you another example that's not as commonly known. Let me get this open. So, Zappos. Has anybody heard of Zappos? Okay, cool. So they are an online shoe retailer in America. And they were founded by a guy called Nick Simon in 1999. But in 1998, he was supposed to be going to a wedding, and he spent a whole month every Saturday running around malls trying to find a pair of shoes that he could wear. Every store either had the wrong size, the wrong colour, and he was pretty pissed off about that. So he had a look online, and in 1998, you couldn't buy shoes online. You could go to a shoe manufacturer's website, but it was almost just like a gallery of what shoes they offered, and funnily enough, which store you could try and get them from. So he had an idea where he believed that people would pay for shoes online. And he actually went to a banker and said, I've got this idea, I think, you know, it would really work. And he said in his origin kind of story that the banker actually just laughed at him and was like, who the fuck wants to buy shoes online? How do you know what size you are? Do you know if they're going to fit? So again, he was like, no, there's got to be a demand for this. So he ran an experiment. And this is apparently what websites look like. Oh, it's so pixelated, so I'm really sorry. It doesn't make it look any better, even if there was more pixels. So, God, it's really bad, isn't it? So what Nick did was he ran what, well, some people call it a Wizard of Oz experiment, or other people may call it a concierge experiment. So because Nick didn't have the money to buy all of these shoes and store them somewhere, as an alternative, he went to all of the stores in these malls in his local area, and he said to them, let me photograph your shoes and let me put them on my website. Whenever a customer buys them, I will come in, I will buy the shoes from you, and I will post them to the customer. Well, most of the stores said yeah, because as long as they got their money, they were happy. So he did that. He got somebody else to build this website, and so he started running his experiment. So the reason it's called a Wizard of Oz experiment is because it's a mixture of reality and not. It's like a digital and a real experience at the same time. So while the customers were on this website, buying the shoes, paying the money, and waiting for it to be delivered, Nick was calling up all of these shoes, being like, somebody's ordered this, can you put it on the side for me? Then he would physically go into these shops, he would buy the shoes, and he would post them. He wasn't making any money at this time, he was literally just breaking even. So he ran the experiment for 6 months, and he ran it up until he could no longer keep up with the amount of orders coming in, and it seems like it accelerated incredibly quickly. So after 6 months, he just shut the website down temporarily, and he went back to the same banker because he validated his hypothesis and he secured his investment. And in 2009, Zappos were kind of acquired by Amazon for about $1.2 billion, and they're still doing really well now. So again, he had a hypothesis, he had a simple test, and he validated that, and now that company's doing really well. I'm going to show you one more MVP. Company name for obvious reasons. So this is a scenario that I've actually experienced personally not too long ago. So the product owner met with an existing client, and the existing client had a really good idea, and they wanted some sort of like new technology to help them run their meetings better. What they wanted was a way to convert a video of their meeting into text, almost like a transcript, if you will, for, you know, obviously for reasons such as like accessibility, people who were deaf. So the product owner, he came back and was like, this is a really, really good idea. They would be quite expensive to bring into production. So what they did is the product owner took the idea to the board and he gave them all these fancy graphs and charts being like, here are these really low costs and these amazing potential revenue things, and it will keep customer retention up and will acquire new customers with this new technology, because nobody at the time offered this solution in the UK. The board bought it, they absolutely loved it, and so production started. The product team, they managed to find the hardware, the technology, they made it in 6 months, and the the main point of this is that the product owner only wanted to ship it with a few features to start off with, just to make sure that people actually wanted it and that they would like it. So I'm going to show you what it kind of looked like. This is just a prototype or a screenshot of it. So you can see there's a video there on the left, and then this is how you can navigate through the meeting, and then there's a transcript underneath. These are actually council meetings. The meetings could last about 3 or 4 hours long, so you can imagine how long that transcript was. So they put in a little search bar just to make it a bit easier to look through. And that was it. I mean, I had no idea what I was doing because it hadn't been tested, I'll be honest with you. But that was about 6 months worth of work. So we shipped it, we told everybody, and how did it do? So nobody used the product at all. And by zero, I mean literally no one. We could even see people going to like the page that it was on and then just going away from it. It was a very sad thing to see. The actual cost of development was just over £100,000 for the project, and we didn't see a return on investment for another 6 months afterwards. The company needed to reduce costs, and I was saying, yeah, they sacked a bunch of people. I'm not saying it was directly because of this fuck-up per se, but as a result of it, people did lose their jobs. And what else happened? Because there wasn't enough staff, performance started dropping the company, and then they actually started losing customers. So how could this MVP go so wrong? So firstly, they relied on a risky assumption. They just assumed that the client was onto a really good idea and the product owner really bought into it. But what we didn't know if whether there was actually a market need for it, whether there was actually a problem that needed to be solved, or whether it was a very severe problem. The other problem was that the solution wasn't tested before release. I even said to my product owner at the time, why don't we run an MVP? And he was like, we're already running an MVP. It's fine, we're shipping it with a few features. I was like, that's not what MVP means. Oh, you should have seen my face when he said that to me. But the other problem was we didn't set any metrics for success or failure. So even if people did use our product, we wouldn't have known whether it was good, if there was any more problems with it, if we could have iterated further. And it was just an absolute shambles, to be honest with you. So the reason I'm doing this talk is because I don't want people to run MVPs like this. I'd rather run MVPs like Zappos and Dropbox did. Successful MVPs that always give you a high level of insight. So what I have are 7 steps to conduct an MVP. Okay, so step 1 is really simple. Define the problem. So it's the most important step at the beginning of any project or any MVP. You want to understand what the problem is that you're trying to solve. Why is it a problem? Have you tried to tackle this problem before and it didn't work? You know, what has sparked this this whole process in the first place? It could be something really simple, like your customers aren't staying with you, you're losing retention, and you're not sure why, trying to figure that out. It's really good at this stage to try and write a problem statement. And I've given you just a small template here, I'll read it out. We've observed that this product or service isn't meeting these goals or needs, which is causing this adverse effect. How might we improve this so that our product or service is more successful based on these measurable criteria? These statements are really, really good. I found that they're really the best way to get senior stakeholders invested in what you're trying to do. It makes it look a little bit more official. So once you've got your problem statement, the next thing you want to do is identify the users. This is just as important as the first step. So who are the users? Where are they? What pain points have we already picked up? What goal are they trying to achieve by using your product or service? Again, it's really important that you know who you're building for. Once you know your users, the next step is to create a hypothesis statement. So this is the point in the project where you would be really trying to share your ideas and think about how you can change a negative experience into a positive one. But remember, at this stage, you don't have any absolute truths yet. These are all just your assumptions. So what you're looking to do is test your riskiest assumption. Again, it's a great idea to write a hypothesis statement and share it with other stakeholders to make sure everybody understands what it is that you're trying to achieve. So the beginning of your statement would be, we believe that doing this, building this feature, or creating this experience for these users, which you've already identified, will achieve this outcome. So once you've got your hypothesis statement, decide how you're going to test. I'm not going to go through all of them, but there are about 40 different ways that I've found already that you can conduct an MVP. They're incredibly flexible, and I do recommend looking into it. So now you've got your hypothesis, think about Dropbox. You know, they did a simple one page. Zappos did another page, but only half of it actually worked. So there are different ways that you can make it work. But yeah, just remember, the experiment is not the attempt to actually build something. It's not that. It's you're building something with the intention of testing it. It's not 100% set in stone.
So once you know how you're going to test,
you want to agree on your metrics for success and failure. So my advice would be to set SMART goals, you know, specific, measurable, achievable, relevant, and time-bound. I mean, I got taught that at GCSE and I still use it today. It's quite useful. Mm-hmm. But the key thing about this point is, if you don't set metrics, you're not running an experiment, and then you're not running an MVP. Your metrics don't need to be anything particularly complicated. So if you go back to my previous example where, say, customer retention has gone down, perhaps your success metric would be, if in the 2 weeks that we run this test, we expect to see a 10% increase. If we don't see a 10% increase, that would be a failed experiment and we need to do something about it. So it doesn't need to be too in-depth, but you need to make sure it's known to everybody as well. Another good piece of advice would be that make sure you can shut down your experiment very quickly. So if you think about Zappos, after 6 months he couldn't cope with the orders, so he shut his website down. So if your MVP is accidentally causing a negative experience, you want to be able to shut it off really bad. Or if it's doing so well and you can't cope with how well it's going, you need to be able to shut it down so you can develop it fully. Okay, so at the end of that stage, you should have a full hypothesis statement. And again, share this with the other stakeholders and other people in your team. So it would be, we believe that doing this, building this feature, creating this experience for these users will achieve this outcome. We will know this to be true when we see this feedback, quantitative measure or qualitative insights. Once you've got that, you're ready to run your experiment. Once you've finished your experiment, whether that 2 week sprint has passed, whether you've hit your metric or whether you've noticed your customers are getting pissed off, have a retrospective. You want to look back at your hypothesis statement and say, how did we do? Did we achieve the metric? Were we anywhere near close? Do we need to move on to development? Did we get any viable user feedback? But overall, you're trying to answer the question, was your MVP a success or not? Actually, a trick question. Your MVP will always be a success if you've got the metrics, because even if you don't hit those metrics, like that 10%, for example, you're still going to learn a lot in those 2 weeks. So it's always good to reflect on that. Once you've had your retrospective, you need to make a decision. Do you pivot or do you persevere? So for a persevere example, like were your metrics, let's go back to the 10% increase in sales, were the metrics like 9%, so you decide to persevere for another week? Just let it run for one more week and just see whether you've actually achieved that goal. Or did you achieve 15% over 2 days and the sales team can't cope with the amount of orders coming in, so you need to shut it down temporarily and then build it fully? Or was it absolutely crap and you decide to pivot and realise this isn't the right way to solve this problem, let's try something else? But whatever you do, don't just leave it running in the background and let it go stale. So, the 7-step process: define the problem, identify the users, create a hypothesis statement, decide how you're going to test, agree on success and failure metrics, have a retrospective, and then decide whether you want to pivot or persevere. So, in conclusion, we've defined what an MVP actually is. It's just an experiment at the end of the day. It's got a really, really simple process that I believe everybody can follow. We know how powerful running an MVP can be. It can either go really well or really badly. But the main thing is, you want to be able to shut it down as soon as possible. And finally, I've given you 7 steps for running an MVP, which I hope was useful. And that's it. Does anybody have any questions? No? Yeah, hi.
Oh, yeah. Thank you, Jane. That's really good.
Thank you.
One of the criticisms I hear about the MVPs is because it doesn't necessarily represent your final product, the vision of your final product, is that minimum viable, of course. It can sometimes cause you to find false negatives in that you might not find a trend or a need, but actually there is one, but because you're not necessarily serving it in its entirety. I kind of think of the Dropbox example, like there's probably a risk that by not having that functionality to download the tool, that could have led people to get a bit pissed off by it, maybe not socially share it and not generate the noise there.
Yeah.
But yet there might have been a demand for it, a full product, if that makes sense. So
yeah.
Is there any way to protect against that?
So I guess in my personal experience, I haven't found a way to protect against false negatives, and I have experienced that in the past before. I think that's partly the reason why with an MVP, you have to not just run it the once. When Drew released Dropbox, the first version of it, obviously it didn't have all the features that it had today. So they continued to run MVPs very quickly to then put on the next thing. I think originally you could only upload Word documents and certain XML documents, I believe, and then it wasn't for another year until you could start putting your photos onto Dropbox through testing that out. I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, I think it does, yeah. Maybe. So I guess it's that persevere bit. If you think that actually there might be an opportunity for a false negative in there, you might persevere with another test.
Absolutely. And even at the end of an MVP, I mean, if it does go quite well, sometimes it's better than taking it to the next stage and actually start conducting user research and then moving it forward a little bit more to try and further validate it. I think I answered your question. I'm sorry if I didn't. I'm not very good at this. Somebody else had their hand up. Hi.
Yeah, I got a semantics question. Okay. A boring one. So you're a UX designer. Mm-hmm. Is this the sort of responsibility of a UX person or a product manager, or is that a bit of a silly question and it's not anyone specific responsibility in the team?
I'll give you the best UX answer in the world. It depends. Okay, so I've worked in teams. So the example that I gave about the MVP that went incredibly wrong, it was supposed to be a bit more of a shared responsibility. It was more the product owner would be, let's try and do this, and then it would be me to help him facilitate that. Obviously, in that case, it didn't work very well. But I ran an MVP very recently where I pretty much ran it from start to finish, and I was working with the developers. It really just depends on the team that you're in, the dynamic.
So you were scoping out those 7 steps and...
Yeah, absolutely. But I don't try and do that on my own. Obviously, work with the product owner is obviously the key thing. But during sort of the planning phase for an MVP, I try and get everyone in the team in the room, everyone in the Scrum team, especially the developers as well, because they can tell you how quickly and cheaply they can make something happen. So I see it as more of a collaborative exercise, for sure. Anybody else? John?
Yeah. When you launch, you obviously get the word out of your MVP, you get somebody to come look at it. Have you got any strategies for that?
For promoting an MVP?
Yeah. How do you get people?
Oh, that's a really good question. If it was a new product, I don't know actually. For a new product, I'm not really sure. For existing products, what we did at that previous company is we started like an email and social media campaign, but we knew our customers were already following us on those platforms. So we kind of tried to keep them in touch of how it was progressing over that 6-month period. So we were trying to build an interest around it. Maybe for a new MVP, it would be something like a social media strategy, yeah. Or it would be tending to maybe even things like this, trying to get the word out.
Because you need to try. Two types, as long as if you're a product company, you're trying something new, you your existing mailing list and see how you get.
Yeah, exactly. I guess it depends where your users are and kind of where they get sort of their information from.
I forget what it's called now, but it let you very quickly build one of those sort of splash pages so that you gauge interest before you started building the site. So it's like an MVP landing page builder, which sort of, I remember that being around a couple of years ago, people getting very excited about it, so then they can quickly throw something up online just like, you know.
So did it like market that? Did it like
share I think there was some social stuff around it as well, but people tend to just sort of tweet about stuff.
Yeah, that's probably it. Or there's things like Product Hunt or that other website where you can sort of pitch your ideas on there. I don't know if that's the way things are going now. But yeah, that's... Try that website, John. Sounds really good.
Yeah.
Cool. Well, thank you very much, everybody.
Just curious. What about interdependencies? Because, it's fine with, say, Dropbox, where it's clearly just a single product that you're talking about. But if you have several products that might be interdependent that all need testing, what sort of structure or strategy would you aim at something like that?
For testing various intermediate.
Yeah, if the products will be supporting, so like for instance, you mentioned Spotify, they can put tiny things in wherever they like because they've already got the overriding infrastructure.
Yeah.
But if you're starting out and you need a number of things to work together, then the structuring the minimal viable product, it seems like a much, much larger concern if there are interdependencies. I was just curious if there was a sense of strategy around that.
Okay, that's a really good question. So if it comes to a point where you need different technologies to make your actual full idea work, I mean, you could test something with a prototype that doesn't actually require much development, or if you get someone just to emulate the idea of that. I'm not even sure if an MVP would be the best way to do that. Perhaps be a good old-fashioned, do some research with people in a controlled environment or in like their contextual environment. There's definitely a way you could do that though. I'm up for that challenge, that sounds quite interesting. But yeah, I'm not saying MVP, it's not one size fits all. There are different methods that you could test such an idea. If it's dependent on certain technologies, I want to understand a bit more what actual problem is that you're trying to solve and why you need all of those other products to bring it together. Mm-hmm. Because it might be a case you don't need, you might need one or two, if you need 5 in total. So yeah, I'd definitely explore an MVP as a potential solution, a way to solve that problem though. I hope that helps.
Okay.
Yeah. any more questions, guys?
Do you ever have problems pitching the word minimum to product owners?
I don't even use that word. I use the word experiment. Okay. I don't use MVP because, like I showed you before, there are different words for it out there, and people just keep taking that word, not really understanding what it means, and adding their own meaning to it. But everybody knows what an experiment is, and if they don't, you should pull out a boring academic paper and they can see the boring subtitles. That's probably an advice I should have given you a bit earlier. Maybe don't use MVP, maybe use experiment, because then senior stakeholders who don't really know what you're talking about can't get it wrong as easily. Yeah. Well, they can get it wrong.
That problem of people wanting, pushing for more in an MVP
Yeah, exactly. And I think we've all been there. If not, we're all going to come to it at some point. Just use the word experiment. It's worked quite well for me for the past 6 months. Yeah. Okay. Can I sit down now? Thank you.